Holy Spirit, who is our true teacher and our true mentor. So with a moment of silent prayer, let us pray. And Heavenly Father, we humbly come before you this evening in praise and in worship and in glorification of your name and also the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, we can't thank you enough for all that you have given and provided for us and our families and also for our church. We ask that you continue to watch over us, protect and guide us, providing for our every need according to your will. We ask that you be with us this evening as we study your word and concentrate and focus in our worship and service unto you this evening, and allow this word to be real and meaningful within our lives according to your will. And Father, this evening we pray for Chris Williams, Haley Cronin, and Jody Thompson with their various physical ailments and things that have been going on in their life. And Father, we ask that you bring healing and comfort into their lives. Also be with their family members and bring strength to them by your word and by your spirit. And allow all things to go well according to your will and allow them to get the appropriate treatment and also to heal and recover as Jody now is from her surgery. We ask that you allow her to heal and completely recover and get back into the plan that you have for her and her life. So, Father, we thank you for this time that we have together. We ask that you lead us to focus and concentrate on the word that you have for us this evening. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. All right, if Mary Ellen could come forward for our doxology.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
All right, thank you very much for the doxology. And now let's go to the book of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 1. And as we continue to wrap up this chapter, we're wrapping up the final two verses as well, where we're looking at verses 22 and 23 that talk about Christ's authority. We've already noted his authority over the fallen angels, his authority over all of creation. And now we're focused on his authority over the church, which is you and I, all believers of this church age, which is also called his body. So we're noting various principles and precepts in regard to the authority of Jesus Christ over the church. And when we come back on Thursday night, assuming I get through everything I want to this evening, we will study about spiritual gifts and how to identify our spiritual gift as well. Because that is all about the body of Christ. So we're going to talk about the authority of Jesus Christ this evening. Now, on Sunday, I handed out some notes to you. I think there were 9 points, maybe. I think I got through 3 or 4 of them. But I'm not going to go through the rest of them. So if you want that information, again, just go through the notes, and you've got that information. And again, it's somewhat repetitive, but just focusing on different aspects and different principles in regard to our spiritual walk, in regard to Jesus Christ being our authority. But tonight, I'm going to give you another doctrine in regard to the authority of Jesus Christ. And basically, this doctrine of the seven figures used for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in relation to the church. And there are 7 different titles that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is given within the New Testament scriptures, talking about him and then us in relationship. And each of these give us a unique understanding of his relationship with us on a day-to-day basis, what he is doing for us, what he desires for us, and then what our role and responsibility is within the spiritual realm as well. But in Ephesians chapter 1, in verses 22 through 23, and this is really going to be the first point that we have in this doctrine. Ultimately, Jesus Christ is the head and we are the body. We've been noting that, and this is the first point in this doctrine. And the first of the 7 figures, or 7 different titles that Jesus Christ and the church have been given by analogy. But in Ephesians 1:22, it says, "And he put all things in subjection under his feet." and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. So again, Jesus Christ is the head of the church, and the church has many members. That body is one body in totality, but it's made up of many members, as we've been talking about. And that's why on Thursday night, we're going to come back and talk about spiritual gifts so we can see what the various aspects or the various members of the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, are made up of. Now, there are all kinds of individuals in the church in any given generation. And remember, the body of Christ includes anybody from the day of Pentecost, when the church age began, until the day of the rapture when it ends. Ultimately, all believers in that time period are the body of Christ and will be in heaven. But in any given generation, it's the working, and as I said on Sunday, the organic functioning body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's made up of individuals like you and I, who have different personalities, different strengths, different weaknesses, but we also have different spiritual gifts, although some of us may have the same spiritual gift, or some of you may have the same spiritual gift. But just because you have the same spiritual gift does not mean you are going to do exactly the same thing as the individual next to you who has the same spiritual gift. God's got a unique plan, a ministry, and service for you in regard to your spiritual gift and as part of your aspect of being a member of the body of Jesus Christ. And so when we talk about this body and head, again, it's the analogy of Jesus Christ being the head of the royal family of God, and then he has authority over us. And that's what I really emphasized on Sunday morning for you and really wanted you to understand, as hopefully you are doing, that the day-to-day, and you could even say moment-by-moment authority that Jesus Christ has over your body and over your mind. And again, Jesus Christ desires that authority in our lives. He desires to be our ruler and our leader on a day-to-day basis. But what do we have to do? We have to voluntarily give of ourselves in order for that rulership and authority to take effect within our own personal lives. So as I tried to emphasize on Sunday for you, I want you to realize that you have to give of yourself. Again, God doesn't force himself upon you. He's looking for you to freely give of yourself. Even when God brings divine discipline into our lives, he's not disciplining us to force us into something, but he's trying to get us to wake up from the spiritually dead walk that we're walking in and get back into that spiritual life that we should be walking in on a consistent basis. So God never forces us to do anything. He's always looking for us to voluntarily give of ourselves and to give of ourselves in obedience to Jesus Christ and his word on a day-by-day basis. And so we've been noting this first analogy of the seven different types or seven different figures of Christ in the church in the New Testament. This first one we've been noting in the book of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22 and 23, chapter 2, 16, 4, 4, chapter 5. 1 Corinthians 12 speaks about this as well in Colossians 1, and you see the various verses there. We've already noted all of these passages in the previous doctrines that we've been noting. But to remind you, in Ephesians 4, chapter 4, verse 15, it says, "But speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in all aspects into him who is the head, even Christ." And so Jesus Christ is the authority over our lives. It's all about growing up, growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that's what God designs for us and desires for us each and every day. So the first of these seven analogies or figures of Jesus Christ in the church in regard to his relationship to the church is that he is the head and we are the body. The next one that we're going to note this evening is that he is the shepherd and we are the sheep. Let's turn to the Gospel of John and let's go to chapter 10, the Gospel of John chapter 10. Again, in your New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, those are your four Gospels. And in John chapter 10, Jesus Christ gave a great discourse in regard to him being the shepherd and us being the sheep. And at the same time, he's also foreshadowing what the church age would be all about, because he also is going to, at the end of this discourse, talk about there is no Jew and there is no Gentile, but there is just one, and that ultimately one is in the body of Jesus Christ. We are one sheep, as it were, and he is our shepherd. So in this analogy, we see in John chapter 10, in verses 1 through 18 specifically, and let's read that right now. In John chapter 10, in verse 1, it says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter by the door into the fold of the sheep, but climbs up some other way, he is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is a shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he puts forth all his own, he goes forth before them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. And a stranger they simply will not follow, but will flee from him because they do not know the voice of strangers." And that's kind of also interesting because he's saying, I'm the good shepherd, I'm the true shepherd, and there are a lot of false shepherds out there. There's a lot of false doctrine out there. As we know, Satan himself disguises himself as an angel of light, and his angels also disguise themselves and also purport doctrines of demons as being the light and truth and righteousness like it was the Word of God. So here we see also a discourse on false teachers and false doctrine, but I love what he says. Those who are his aren't going to follow the false way. They're not going to go after the false teacher. They're not going to go after the false doctrines that are here inside of Satan's cosmic system, but they're going to follow the true shepherd, and that is the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that's why, again, when you have a pastor, teacher behind a pulpit, if he is teaching Bible doctrine, again, Jesus Christ is the capital S shepherd, but remember, the pastor teacher is the small S shepherd, the shepherd over that local assembly or that local flock. And that pastor teacher, that little S shepherd, should be teaching the Word of God and taking his cue and direction from one and one only, and that is the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There are many churches out there today that want to teach about philosophy and psychology and, you know, the New Age movements that are going on in the world. They want to talk about politics. They want to talk about, you know, this thing and that thing. But ultimately, a pastor teacher should talk about nothing but the Word of God. That's his responsibility because he is the spokesperson for the great shepherd, that being our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And if that pastor teacher is not teaching Bible doctrine, the Word of God, on a consistent basis, ultimately the true believers are going to vacate that place. They're not going to listen to him for very long because he is not teaching what the shepherd has to say. He's teaching what he wants to say or what the world has to say, and he's teaching basically the falsehoods that are out there inside of Satan's cosmic system. So the true believer will be following the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and they'll know. They'll be able to determine whether a pastor teacher is teaching truth or falsehood or truth or false. Or truth or the lie, let me say it that way, truth or a lie instantaneously. They'll know it right away. And once they hear the lie, they should be getting out of that place because they know that their shepherd, Jesus Christ, is not speaking in that church. Then in verse 6, it says, "This figure of speech Jesus spoke to them, but they did not understand what those things were which he had been saying to them. Jesus therefore said to them again, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and might have it abundantly.'" There Jesus Christ is saying, here, this is what I want to give to my people. This is what I give to my sheep. I want to give them life, and not just life to get by, but life abundantly, where they are producing divine good, where they're going forward in the plan of God. They have the inner happiness and peace of Jesus Christ on a consistent basis. Then we see in verse 12, it says, "He who is a hireling and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, beholds the wolf coming, and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them." In other words, that false doctrine teacher, it's all about him. It's all about what he can gain and all about him filling up his pockets with money or whatever the case may be, or his, you know, ego being boosted up. But he really doesn't care about the people at all. But the true shepherd will care about the people, and he'll teach them so that their souls are protected from the wolves of Satan's cosmic system, the lies, the deceptions that are there in this world. And then in verse 13, it says, he flees because he is a hireling and is not concerned about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with one shepherd. Now, what we have to understand here is Jesus Christ is speaking to predominantly Jews at this point in time, and he's speaking to them, how they too are his sheep, and he came even to save them and provide for them, and they too will be part of the age of grace and church age not many days from the time of Jesus speaking this discourse. And he says, so again, there are others that I'm going to bring in. He's talking about the Gentiles coming now into the church. And as you know, there's no Jew or Gentile in the church age, but we are one body in Christ. It's not the Jews and then everybody else. It's now Jew and Gentile, really all believers in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, making up his body. And as he says here, making up one flock. Again, one flock. And we only have one shepherd. And you can compare that one flock with Ephesians chapter 2, verse 16, that talks about one body, no Jew, no Greek, no Gentile. Again, only one in Christ. Now, back in verse 17, it says, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it up again. There he's prophesying his resurrection. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. You see, even he had to be voluntarily giving of himself to the will and to the plan of the Father. Just as you and I, God desires us to give of ourselves voluntarily rather than being forced to, serve him, which he would never do in the first place. Now in verse 18 again, it says, and no one takes it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. So Jesus Christ is basically saying, I'm the good shepherd. I've come to take care of my flock. And in order for me to take care of my flock, the first thing I need to do is lay down my life. And I'm going to go give that life upon the cross. But that life, even though I lay it down there, guess what? I'm going to take it up again. I'm going to be resurrected. I'm going to ascend. I'm going to be seated at the right hand of the Father. And I am going to provide for my flock for all of eternity. So Jesus Christ is that great shepherd. We are his sheep. And so this analogy really talks about the abundant blessing that God has for each and every one of us. It connotes the great blessings that he has for us. It connotes the security that God has given to us as well. And remember, we have eternal security. Once we are saved, we are always saved. We never lose our salvation, regardless of what any pastor or any religion will tell you. You can never lose your salvation. Once saved, always saved, as we say. And John chapter 10, verse 28 through 30 speaks to that specifically as well. But not only do we have security in this life and in the spiritual life that God has given to us, but there also is the promise of great blessings for both time and then especially when we get to the eternal state. And we've talked about that already in the book of Ephesians, where we have that inheritance waiting for us, that inheritance that is Christ, that we too will receive because we are his body. So the shepherd and the sheep is a fantastic analogy because it talks about God's provisions for us on a consistent basis. And in that sheep analogy, and unfortunately, you know, we have to consider ourselves to be sheep. And what are sheep? They're dumb, okay? They're dumb. And as smart as we think we are, and we are very smart in the human realm, but compare our smartness to God's smartness, then you got to say, well, I guess we're pretty dumb, aren't we? You know, as we think that the sheep are dumb, you know, God's looking at us even as dumber than that, but in a loving way, as you can understand. Again, because he is so knowledgeable and he is all knowledge, as you know. But like the sheep, again, the sheep have no sense of direction. You know, the sheep just go out and they don't know where they're going, why they're going, how they're going. They just go out. And when the shepherd calls them in, they come in. And the sheep don't know how to go find water, go. They don't know how to go find food. They have to be led to water. They have to be led to food. And oh, by the way, if a wolf comes in, or say a lion or some other kind of predator comes in, again, he's just going to be able to attack that sheep very easily. They have no defense mechanism whatsoever. So again, the sheep is a very helpless individual, and they need a shepherd. They need a shepherd to care for them, provide for them, protect them, make sure they're safe and sound in all aspects of their lives. And that's how God looks at us. Not that he looks at us, you know, down his nose in arrogance or anything, but in a loving way, he looks at us and says, you know what? I understand they are helpless. I understand that Satan is more powerful than them, more wise than them, more strong than them. I understand how powerful the sin nature is. I understand what the cosmic system is all about and how powerful temptation is to them each and every day. But you know what? I can help them to overcome that. And I can give them the strength so that they can be victorious. I can give them the food that they need to be successful spiritually each and every day. And that's what we have in the Word of God. And that's why also God has provided those under-shepherds, the smallest shepherd, as I would say, pastor teachers, to teach us the Word of God so that we have the mind of Christ that protects us and guides us each and every day. And that's the Word of God is called our spiritual food. It's called the water as well. And so again, the shepherd provides us food and water for the spiritual life, as well as, you know, he provides for all of our logistical grace blessings as well. So in this analogy of Jesus Christ being the shepherd and we being the sheep, it really talks about God caring for us and providing for us each and every day. And that then causes us to what? Trust in him. Trust in him. Rather than saying, I'm going to tend for myself, I'm going to care for myself, I'm going to provide for myself. You know, we have to trust in God that he's going to open the doors, create the avenues, give us the protection, provide us what we need, give us the answers to the problems and difficulties of life. We need to trust in God because he loves us so much. As our great shepherd, he's going to provide everything we need. We just need to rely upon him and faith rest it and walk in his plan. As 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 25 says, "For you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls." So the shepherd and the guardian of your souls, that is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And in the book of Hebrews chapter 13, we've seen that. 1 Peter chapter 2 talks about this. And so we see the analogy of the shepherd and the sheep. Then the third analogy that we have this evening is the vine and the branches. Now let's turn to the Gospel of John in chapter 15. Gospel of John chapter 15. Now for those of you who have been with this ministry for, I hate to say how many years, probably, you know, it seems like yesterday to me, but it's probably about 3-4 years ago now, we studied the Gospel of John, and we studied this chapter, and we went through this in a lot of detail, and for those who are with us should know this intimately, the vine and the branch analogy. So let's read this passage, and then we'll get into some of the understanding of what this means to us on a day-to-day basis. Jesus Christ, it says, said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser." Now, the vine dresser we would also call, maybe in our language, a gentleman farmer, because he was the landowner and he cared and tended to the overall farm, or in this case, the winery, where the vines and the vineyard would grow. And that's who God the Father is. And again, here it's called the vine dresser. It says, "Every branch," and that's you and I, "in me," notice that we are in union with Jesus Christ, "that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you." Now, that's an interesting little verse in there because it talks about you're already saved. This isn't a passage about salvation. This is a passage of post-salvation and experiential sanctification. Now, in verse 4, he says, "Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." Then in verse 6, we have a warning. "If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up. And they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned." Now, this doesn't talk about losing your salvation or being cast into the lake of fire. It's really talking about divine discipline and going out potentially under the sin unto death, the third stage of divine discipline. In verse 7, it says, "If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it shall be done for you. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit and to prove to be my disciples." So, the vine and the branch. And here we understand the union that we have with Jesus Christ. Every branch that is in me. And you see, every believer is in Christ. We are all in union with Jesus Christ. In other words, we are all a branch on the great vine called our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And what does the vine do? Well, the vine pumps the nutrients and the nourishment from the roots of the ground into the branch. And then what does the branch do? The branch grows, and it also does what? Produces fruit. The vine doesn't produce fruit, but the branch does. But the branch can only produce fruit when it's attached to the vine. If it's not attached to the vine, it can produce no fruit whatsoever on its own. So this whole passage is really talking about us being not only positionally in union with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but have our experiential walk with Him day in and day out. And continue, as you're doing tonight, take in the Word. Learn about this spiritual food that God has for you, this spiritual water that God has for you. Take it into your soul. And by doing that, you will grow spiritually. And what we have here are three stages of spiritual growth, where you bear fruit, you bear more fruit, and then you bear much fruit. And we call that the three stages of spiritual adulthood: spiritual self-esteem, spiritual autonomy, and then ultimately spiritual maturity. And God designed us or desires us to grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And by tapping into the vine and understanding that He is the one that supplies all the sustenance that we need, He is the one that gives us all the nutrients and nourishment that we need to go forward in the spiritual life. He is the one. Remember that the Holy Spirit has given us a spiritual gift at the moment of our salvation. Jesus Christ is then the one that teaches us and trains us through His Word how to apply that. And He also is the head, giving us instruction as to what to do with that spiritual gift, where to do it, when to do it, and then also how to do it as well. So the vine is very important. And we need to be in tune to the vine. If we sever ourselves from the vine by saying, you know what, I want to live in the cosmic system. You know what, I don't want to take in the Word of God. You know what, I'm going to live my own life. If we sever ourselves voluntarily, ultimately the branch has been cut off and we cannot produce anything. But when we stay in tune and we stay in relationship with Jesus Christ on a consistent basis, we will grow spiritually and we will produce divine good production, the fruit of the Spirit, in our daily lives as we grow spiritually, grow stronger and stronger each and every day. And what's interesting here is that the whole cutting off aspect that we have here about the vine dresser cutting off the branches that don't produce fruit, it's a protection that God the Father has for the church and for each local assembly, and also for the overall body of Christ. And you might have witnessed that in your life, and I've certainly witnessed it in my life. But if you are surrounded with believers, don't think that all believers are the same. Because sometimes believers are cosmic believers and reversionistic believers, and they really aren't going forward in the plan of God, and there's no fruit in their life. And I've seen situations where I've been in association with people, and then ultimately God will cut me off from them or cut them off from me somehow in some way, remove them. And I've seen people removed from their local assembly so that the rest are protected. Because God knows that, again, like one rotten apple spoils a whole bunch or whatever that analogy is, okay? God knows that if there are individuals who aren't producing divine good, He's going to cut them off and get them out of the way of the other people who want to produce divine good. And just to give you some more analogy, again, my son, doing organic farming right now, and he planted a peach tree in my backyard. We also have an apple tree. And my son has been teaching me how to prune those trees so that they produce maximum fruit. And the fact of the matter is, if you don't prune a tree, the branches are just going to grow like this. And you might think, oh, more branches, more fruit. Well, it doesn't work that way. Because what happens is, you know, some of the branches are dead, and some of the branches, you know, one branch is just going to block the sun from the other branch. And so one branch isn't going to get all the nutrient it should. And so to have a good fruit tree or a good vineyard, or, a vineyard as we would say here, ultimately you got to prune some of those branches away. Somebody once gave me a good analogy to how do you know that you've pruned your apple tree good enough? They said, well, as long as a bird can fly through it. As long as there's enough room for a bird to fly through it, which means there's enough room for it to grow, enough for sunlight to come in. And oh, by the way, with too many branches, there are resources getting sucked out that are just doing no good for anybody. And therefore, there's not enough resources to go around. So what God will do is ultimately remove some individuals who are just dead weight and bloodsuckers, as we would call them within a local assembly, get them out of there, so that then those who are going forward in the plan of God, desire to go forward, they can get all the nutrient that they need. They can study the Word of God without coercion, without distraction, and without problems and difficulties. And God, the Father, is the one who does that. Sometimes He takes people out through the sin unto death and the stages of divine discipline. Other times He just gets them out of your life so that now you can flourish and grow. And never be disappointed when somebody is removed from your life. Never be disappointed, because God knows what you need. And if you're going forward in His plan, He's going to remove people from your life so that you can, and put other people in your life so that you can go forward in His plan like never before. So again, we have to, in faith rest, continue to trust in God that He knows better than we do. And He's got a plan, and He's going to take me right through this plan that He has for me. And He's providing for all the things so that all I need to do is walk in that plan. Again, you don't have to figure out all the details. Just walk. Just go forward. And take every day as a new day. And take every day as a new experience. And every day is God showing you something and training you something and giving you something. Up to Albany for 2 years to, start a church. And I thought, okay, this is where I'm going to have a ministry for the rest of my life. 2 years later, what did I do? I'm right back in my own backyard with a church. Like, well, how'd that happen? Okay. But you see, God knew I needed to go away for 2 years and have a ministry there before I would be prepared to come back and have a ministry here. You know, so God knows, and He uses us all the time. And He uses people in our lives all the time and gets people out of the way that are going to be bloodsuckers and dragging us down rather than allowing us to go forward inside of God's plan as He desires us to go forward. All right, now we see the next analogy that we've also already noted, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because we noted this last week, but we have the chief cornerstone and the stones of the building. And Jesus Christ is considered the chief cornerstone, and we are the stones. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16, because this is really where all this began. And then later on in the New Testament, we see that actual cornerstone analogy being utilized several times. But in Matthew chapter 16, in verses 16 through 18, this is one of those that this is a passage that is, highly debated within the quote-unquote church, because some take this to be, oh well, Peter was said to be the rock, and ultimately Peter now is the first pope that ever came into existence, and now our church is a succession of popeship or an apostleship passed down from Peter, down to where we are today with a pope who sits in Rome. But that's a misinterpretation, a misunderstanding of this passage. You know, God wasn't saying, Peter, you're the church and everything's going to be based on you. And when you look at the Greek, Jesus Christ was very clear. He says, I'm the rock. Jesus Christ said, I am the rock Himself. And upon me, the church is going to be built. And you're just a little piece of that. And you're one of the small stones that come off of the cornerstone, as we have noted in previous chapters, but we're going to see here as well. So in Matthew 16:16, it says, and Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said to him, Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, son of Jonas, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter. Now in the Greek it says you're Petros. And upon this Petra, he says. Now he uses Petros in one, then he says Petra in this second one. He says, and let me go back to it. I lost my place here. He says, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not overpower it. You see, Petros means a little rock that's a fragment of a rock or a chip of a rock that comes off of a larger one. But Petra is the large rock, and sometimes people even say it's the granite mountain. And so when Jesus Christ, he says, you're Petros, he says, but upon Petra, and he's pointing back at himself, upon Petra I will build my church, upon me. You see, Jesus Christ is the cornerstone. Peter's not the cornerstone. He's not the cornerstone of the church. Jesus Christ is. And we see that in Ephesians 2:20, which we've already noted, and then also 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 8. So in verse 16 through 18, when Jesus Christ said that I am the rock and upon this rock I will build my church, he ultimately is saying that he is the cornerstone and from him the church will be built. And as I gave to you by analogy this past week, and again, this is a point I just made. Christ is the ultimate rock. He is the cornerstone. And the church comes from him and nowhere else. Again, the church is Jesus Christ. And even in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 through 15, the Apostle Paul said, I built a foundation, which was Jesus Christ. And upon that foundation, other people have come and built. So Jesus Christ is the foundation. He is the cornerstone. We are the stones. We're part of the church, we're the building, we're the temple of God, but it's all based on him being the cornerstone. In other words, we can't build a church on our own. We can't be the body of Christ on our own. We can't go off and think, you know, with our man-made ways and our man-made religion and our own, man-made thoughts and opinions that we're going to do something great for the world and for God. No, it's through our head, Jesus Christ. It's based on him. And it's based on his word that is then resonant within our soul. And so this depicts Jesus Christ as that cornerstone, as I gave you that analogy this past week. In the ancient days when they would build the house, again, they didn't have wood like we do, but they'd build it with blocks. And that cornerstone had to be precise in angle, had to be laid precisely so that when you lay that cornerstone, then two walls could go off of it. And then from those two walls, two more walls could connect, and the whole building would be absolutely perfect. Well, when we have that analogy of Jesus Christ as the rock or the cornerstone, and then two walls coming off of it, what are the two walls? One is the Jews, the other is what? The Gentiles, which create one what? Temple. One body, one house, one temple that is God's, and also one body that is Jesus Christ. So we see that Jesus Christ is the head of both the Jews and the Gentiles. He is the ruler of both, especially in this church age in which we are living in, when there is no Jew or Gentile, but all are one in Christ. And so we see that prophesied in Zechariah 10, chapter 10, verses 3 and 4, Psalm 118, 22, then Matthew 21, 1 Peter 2, and as we've already noted in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20. And here's what Psalm 118, verse 22 prophesied. It says, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. That's the Petra that we're talking about. And again, the ones that the builders rejected, the Jews were to be the builders of the church, but they rejected their Messiah when he came as a people and as a religion. Even though the apostles were all Jews and many Jews became believers, but as a people and religion, they rejected Jesus Christ. But ultimately, regardless of their rejection of him, guess what? He still is the cornerstone. And we are the stones, those who believe in him, that make up the building or the temple of God. All right, then our fifth analogy of the seven that we have before us this evening. The fifth analogy is that he is the high priest, and we are a kingdom of priests. And we've talked about this in the past, and we see it here in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17, also in 3:1, 5:6, and also verse 10. and Jesus Christ being our high priest. Again, going back to the analogy of Israel when they were under the law and the Levitical priesthood that God and Jesus Christ had set up for the people of Israel. And even though there was the tribe of Levi that made up the Levitical priesthood, they were all the priests, there was always one high priest that was elected each year that would be kind of the head of the priesthood. And Moses and Aaron were the first in that lineage back when they came out of Egypt. So when we have the high priest and a kingdom of priests, we see that Jesus Christ is a head, a ruler of all of us, because we are, and we've seen this before, but I'm going to show it to you again in 1 Peter chapter 2, but we are all considered what? Priests. Every believer in the church age is considered to be a priest. During the age of Israel, only the Levites could be priests. But during the age of the church, every believer is a priest. And not only are we priests, but we're royal priesthood because we're part of the royal family of God. And Jesus Christ is the high priest that gives us direction, leads us, guides us as a priesthood. And remember, what was the priest to do? Well, the priest represented the people to God and represented God to the people. Again, they were the spokesperson and the go-between God and the congregation of the people. And as we have Jesus Christ being the high priest and we're the priests, again, we're that workening, as I said on Sunday, the workening, functioning, organic body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're the material aspect of the body of Christ here on planet Earth. And we take our direction from the head because we are his body. Well, the same analogy goes, he's the high priest and has the final say and decision in our service, in our work, and how we're going to represent him here on planet Earth. And now, given the cues and given the direction from him as our high priest, we take his orders, we go forward. In other words, we take his word that has been given to us, and we go out and we share that with a lost and dying world. We manifest God. We manifest Jesus Christ to this world as he has directed us to do so within his word. And again, we do that through our lives and through our lips. It's one thing to preach the gospel, but it's another thing to live the gospel, and we need to do both. So in Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1, it says, therefore, holy brethren, partakers of a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. Again, of our confession, this is the one we believe in. This is the one we trust in. This is the one we're following. This is our confession. And he is our high priest, and he has authority over us and is leading us to be his representatives as we go about our priestly functions each and every day. And remember back in Israel, the priestly functions, they officiated over what? All the sacrifices. They officiated over the singing of the choir and the music that would preach and worship of our Lord. They would officiate over all the aspects of the worship ceremony for the people in the congregation. And you and I ought to represent that in our day and age as well. We ought to show the world who Jesus Christ is, because all those sacrifices, all those worship, all those songs, all of those things, everything that they did were what? Showing the Israelites who God was and what Jesus Christ would do for them. And that's what we're here to do in our daily lives. And so when we see the God-man, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, ascended and seated at the right hand of the Father, at that point in time, he also was given the office of now being our high priest over a kingdom of priests, being you and I, church-age believers. And we see that, and you can read that on your own. Just for time's sake, I'm not going to read those passages. But Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25, chapter 10, 10, and then also verse 14, chapter 10, 10, all the way to verse 14. Missing a dash point there. But as our high priest, again, remember, he is in like form as we are. He's a man just like you and I are. And as our high priest, it also qualified him because he is like us and suffered as we did, was tempted in all things that we are tempted in. It qualified him to be our advocate, to be our intercessory. And he is, according to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18. Jesus is there defending us. Jesus is there providing for us. Jesus is there supporting us in regard to God the Father who is sitting right next to him each and every day. He is our advocate. He's looking out for us, and he's there to help and provide for us each and every day. So because he is a royal high priest, every believer in the church age is also a royal priest. And these are the verses that you may be familiar with, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 through 9. But then also in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 6 and 5:10, talk about us being a priesthood. And not just priests, but royal priesthood. And when we talk about Jesus Christ as a royal priest, without getting into too much detail and, not even want to lay down too much on you, but you might have heard the name Melchizedek before. Have you ever heard the word Melchizedek? Okay. Well, it's actually a name, and it was a name of a very unique individual that had relationship with Abraham back in the day. And when Abraham went into a country, Melchizedek came out to him and actually shared bread and wine with him, very interestingly, and gave him, a welcome. And this individual, Melchizedek, was a king, but not only was he a king, but he was a priest too, which was unique. You see, in the Israelite nation, there was never an individual who was both a king and a priest. You had the priesthood under the Levites, and then you had the king that ultimately started with Saul, but then came down through the line of David. And the two never were combined until our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ came along. And with Jesus Christ, it says in the book of Hebrews as well, he's a king in the order of Melchizedek. A very obscure, unique individual we don't see much about, interestingly enough, just as Jesus Christ kind of came and went. But Melchizedek was a king and a priest. Jesus Christ is a king and a priest all at the same time. He has authority, and he leads us in the worship and service of God the Father, as you know. But we are royal high priests because we are part of his family, and we are in Christ, so therefore we too are royalty, and therefore royal priests. And as royal people, we are commanded to uphold a royal law, as we call it, the Royal Family Honor Code. And that Royal Family Honor Code is in James chapter 2, verse 8 specifically, which I'm going to show you in just a minute. But we also see this throughout the Bible, starting with the book of Leviticus, but now coming into the New Testament as well. And it starts with, love your neighbor as you love yourself. But remember, Jesus Christ even gave us a greater commandment. He said, yeah, I know you should love your neighbor as you love yourself, but let's take it up a notch. Love your neighbor as I have loved you. And what did Jesus Christ do? He gave his life for us. He gave his life for us. And so this royal family honor code that we have is, as the book of Romans chapter 13 says, you fulfill the whole law when you abide by one commandment. Love your neighbor. And by love, you fulfill the whole law. Impersonal, unconditional love, which means you treat people with dignity and respect. Even if they're, in your face, you give them love right back. You don't take vengeance. You don't get revenge. You don't get angry towards them. You don't, take violence and matters into your own hands. You love your neighbor as you love yourself, and you give them grace. As James chapter 2, verse 8 says, if, however, you are fulfilling the royal law, and there it is, according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. You are doing well. So again, love your neighbor as you love yourself. But remember, Jesus took it up a notch too. And said, love your neighbor as, love one another as I have loved you. And when you do that, again, you're not gossiping, maligning, slandering, backstabbing, stealing, cheating, whatever the case may be. You're not doing any of that stuff, because you care more about others than you do about yourself. And you're giving grace to others as you want grace given to you as well. So again, we see the high priest and the royal high priest, the royal high priest and then the family of royal priesthood that you and I are. Now we see in our sixth principle, in the sixth figure of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, is that he is called the last Adam, and that we are also called the new creation. And this is a very interesting one. We see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. There, let's go to 1 Corinthians 15. You're in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. Corinthians is the next book. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And in verses 45 and 47, and as you know, this is one of the great resurrection and resurrection body passages. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 45, it says, "So also it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man is from the earth, earthy. The second man is from heaven. As is the earthy, so are also those who are earthy. And as is the heavenly, so also are those who are heavenly. And just as we have been born the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly." So it's interesting that Jesus Christ is called the last Adam. And in this analogy, we see that title, but we compare that also with 2 Corinthians 5:17 and Galatians chapter 6:15, which are the two passages that say that the born-again believer is what? A new creature, a new creation. As we call that, a new spiritual species. And that's what we are when we're born again. We're a new spiritual species. We're a new creation. And we're a new creation from the first creation, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we have the first Adam, and now we have the last Adam. The first Adam, interestingly enough, God provided somebody for him. You see, the first Adam, God provided a bride for him. And what did God do? Well, he put Adam in a deep sleep. He took one of his ribs and took that rib out of Adam and then took it aside and then enclosed that rib in flesh and formed the woman. And then brought her to Adam and said, "This is now your helpmate." And then you have the whole the marriage ceremony there. The two shall leave their, the husband and wife shall leave their mother and father, and the two shall become one. And so we have that whole analogy with the first Adam, that the first Adam was created, and from him came a second creation, and again a helpmate, and the two became one. We have the same analogy here with the last Adam, where Jesus Christ came on, took care of the sins of the world, and based on his work upon the cross, a new body could be formed. And just as God took a rib from Adam and created a helpmate for him, and the two became one, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and his work upon the cross, he is creating us now as the body of Christ. And being in union with him is like the analogy of the rib and with the flesh enclosed around it. So again, a fantastic analogy of this relationship that we have, and in the plan of God that he provided a bride for the first Adam, the plan of God also provided a bride for the last Adam. And that's another analogy, again, the bride and the bridegroom, which we're going to see in just a minute, but it has application here to the phrase, the last Adam, and then you and I being the new creation. As Adam was created, then Eve was created from him. Jesus Christ came on and won the victory of the spiritual life, and now we are created from his victory on the cross, and we are now in a new spiritual body, and we are now new creatures and a new creation. So the plan of God provided a bride for the last Adam as well. And it's interesting, as God provided for Adam in the garden, the first Adam in the garden, he said, "You know what? You know, remember when Adam went around and he named all the animals and, you know, everybody had a mate?" And he looked at himself and said, "Wait a minute, I'm all by myself." And God said, "It's not good for him to be alone. So I'm going to create a helpmate for him." Well, when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ hung on the cross, was anybody with him? Well, we know the Holy Spirit was, but anybody else? Okay. Any other bodily form? Absolutely not. He was all alone on the cross. God the Father said the same thing for him. It's not good for him to be alone. So therefore, he created a body for the last Adam, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so that body now is you and I, and we will be that body forever and ever because we are the new creation. He is that head, as in all these analogies. He's the head, he's the authority, he's the lead. And ultimately, we make up individually the members of that overall body that is here on earth, that does represent him and functions and operates for him on this earth. And so that then gets us to the last of the seven figures and the seven analogies of Jesus Christ and his church found in the New Testament. And the last one is that he is the bridegroom and we are the bride. And that can be found in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, 2, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 27. And then we really see this coming together in Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 through 8. Let's go to Revelation chapter 19. Again, last book of the Bible. Revelation chapter 19 and verses 6 through 8. So let me give you up on the board here before we get to that. 2 Corinthians 11, 2, it says, "For I am jealous for you, with a godly jealousy. For I betrothed you to one husband, that to Christ I might present you as a pure virgin." And again, Paul talking about leading people to the body of Christ and ultimately saying, you're now betrothed to the one and only, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And he is your husband and you are his bride, or you will be his wife, but right now we're just considered to be his bride. And so this ultimately will be fulfilled when we get to heaven, after the rapture of the church, towards the end of the tribulational time period, that seven-year time period when we will be in heaven with our Lord. And at that time, in Revelation chapter 19, it talks about a great marriage ceremony, and following that, a great wedding feast. And that is really we would say the consummation of our marriage to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Right now we're the bride, he's the bridegroom, but in Revelation 19 that will be consummated and he will be our husband and we will be his wife for all of eternity. And then the coolest thing about that, well, that is the coolest thing, but the second coolest thing about that is right after that, guess what we get to do? We come back with him on horses and we wipe out Satan and his angelic, demonic forces here on planet Earth at the end of the tribulational time period. We come back with him as warriors, a bunch of Amazon warriors, I guess, all those women. I guess we're all going to be women. No, we're not, but you know what I mean. But in any case, we're going to be his wife and ultimately come back with him during that time after the end of the tribulation. So let's read about that. Let's look at Revelation chapter 19. And in verse 6, it says, "And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty peals of thunder, saying, Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad, and give the glory to him. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. And it was written to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. And he said to me, Write, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, These are true words of God." So again, this is after we go through the Bema Seat of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now we do have our rewards and blessings and we're decorated in our resurrection body at that point in time. Now we're ready for the marriage and the marriage ceremony. And that's going to take place, as I said, at the end of the tribulational time period. And then when you get down to verses 11 and beyond, ultimately now you see us coming back victoriously with him to wipe out Satan and his world forces. So ultimately, this bride will be displayed, and that's what we're going to see. And also in Revelation chapter 21, verse 9, let's just turn there right now. And now we're jumping forward to after the millennial reign. Because remember, we come back with Christ at the end of the tribulation to usher in the millennial reign. Now the 1,000 years is over. Satan is locked away. Unbelievers are thrown into the lake of fire. And then it says in verse 9, "In one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and spoke with me, saying, Come here, I shall show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And so therefore, we're going to be displayed and we're going to be on display again and in our perfected states, glorifying God forever and ever. Again, ruling with Him, being empowered by Him, and sitting on the throne with Him for all of eternity. So these seven figures are given to us throughout the New Testament scriptures so that we can understand our relationship with Jesus Christ. Overall, yes, we understand the authority that He has over us on a day-by-day basis, but in these analogies, we see more of the interpersonal relationship that we have with our Lord and that He desires to have with us, and what also we can benefit from Him by tapping into the nutrients of His Word that is found within the Scriptures. And therefore, we will glorify God as we go forward in His plan. All right, so I'll leave it off there, and we'll come back on Thursday night talking about the body of Christ and spiritual gifts and how you can discover your spiritual gift as well. So we'll talk about that on Thursday night. So let's just close in prayer right now. Father, we thank You for this time of praise and worship. We thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ, and His victory on the cross for our salvation and for giving us all here entrance into Your family and considering us to be His body and to be in our priesthood. And Father, we just can't thank You enough for all the blessings that You have provided for us. And we ask that You continue to pour those things out onto us so that we can be more effective in our witness for You, demonstrating to a lost and dying world Your love, grace, and mercy. So Father, we ask that You give us travel blessings on the way home this evening. In Christ's precious name, amen.